Dr. Rajendra, Abbyankar, he is a senior orthopedic surgeon in Kolkata city. He did his MS ortho in 1986 from VMS Medical College, Solapur, and sports medicine. He is a founder president of Hospital Associations of Kolkata, and he has written a book on doctors and the law. He is a perfect person to speak on this topic. He knows all the rules and regulations related to the medical practice, what government is expecting and enforcing on, and what again we are expected to practice as ethics. He is a faculty of several medical conferences. He has given guest lectures in almost 20 IIM branches, presented scientific papers in state conferences. He is executive committee member of Indian Ortho Association from 2009 to 2016. So very senior, most great personality We will hear from you what exactly ethics is in a day-to-day practice.
As Dr. Patil has introduced, ethics is a topic which usually very few people know about it. But as a student, even if you do not know or you do not read, when you come into the practice, especially medical practice, particularly in this area, this era rather than the area. When Dr. Shirke, Dr. P.G. Kulkarni, my friend Patil, and we all started practicing, it was not a big issue. Because legal and ethical considerations were not conflicting, but with lots of laws coming into play, not year by year, even by day, we have to be very careful, and there is a very thin line between what is ethical and what is non-ethical. MCI, MFC, they do give guidelines about the ethical practices, but most of the times these guidelines are useful as a general guideline. You will be able to read it on the net. It is available, saying that you do this, you don't do this, you do that, and you don't do that. But when it comes to the clinical practice, where you have a patient in front of you, and then you are stuck up with taking some decision, which in your mind you have a question whether what I am doing is ethical or not. That solution is not given in any textbook, those guidelines are not given by MCI or MFC. So I thank Dr. Anita Pune, who has given me the topic of experiences in clinical practice about the ethics. Now, first of all, what we are going to do is define the ethics. Dictionary defines the principles of right and wrong that are accepted by an individual or a social group. So when we say what is ethical, we have to define. If you do this, it is ethical. If you do this, it is non-ethical. Now again, there are two types. One is individual, as an individual what you feel, and as a social group, what you are doing is ethical or unethical. I will give you only one example. Being an orthopedic surgeon, most of my examples will be related to the orthopedic surgeon. So as an individual, when a patient of backache comes to me, clinically I can know almost 99% that what he is suffering from. Even I can know what is the level of the disc, whether it is compressing the root or the spine or the chord, whatever. But I will have to send the patient to MRI before doing surgery. So even if I am clinically 100% sure what it is, I will have to document it, because it is a legal mandate nowadays. Now the MRI shows that there is a disc at L3, L4 level. But my clinical findings are the disc is definitely compressing the root of L5, that is L4, L5 disc. Now I am in the dilemma. Now this becomes an individual decision about ethics and non-ethics. A person like me will say, as my clinical diagnosis is L4, L5 and MRI shows L3, L4, no L4, L5 disc, I am not going to operate this patient. Because taking out L3, L4 disc may not cure me. But somebody will say, yeah, MRI is showing that disc, so I need to take out that disc also, because it may in the future produce compression and complications and this and that. This is where your personal individual ethics come into play. I hope you are getting. So these dilemmas, they will not be described in any textbook or any guidance of the medical counselor. The second definition of ethics is a system of principles governing the morality and acceptable conduct. That is why societies, they come together and decide what is ethical, what is non-ethical, and then MCI also keeps on changing the guidelines of the ethics, because as the communities change, the ethics also change. This is a famous picture from Mahabharata. In those days, they never used to fight after the sunset. You know, these were the rules of the war then. But now, is it possible? No. We do surgical strikes only at night with night vision cameras, night vision goggles, and all that. So what was unethical in Mahabharata's day is ethical today. So as the communities change, the ethics also change. So we have to always keep revising the ethics. Calling your mom or dad, a mom, a dad, was not acceptable. But I think the new generation, they will call for the father and mother, Are Baba. It was not possible in at least my days. So that we will have to remember. Ethics is not a fixed thing. These are not commandments given by somebody who you are going to follow pages for. It can change. As I said, it can change individually. One individual can have a different ethics than another individual. Now these are some things which I have picked up from the site of Medical Council of India. Duties and responsibilities of the physician in general. Now they start with the character of the physician. How you are supposed to dress, how you are supposed to behave. Again, that also keeps changing. I still remember, Ravi Patil may also remember, when we were in the first year, the anatomy department was so strict that we have to button the whole thing right up to here. Forget about wearing jeans and t-shirts and all that. This, today, I don't think anybody is using that. So, dressing up is also described by MCI. The physician shall uphold the dignity and honor of the profession. Uski niche sab diya hua hai. The important point area where I would like you to focus is, whosoever chooses his profession assumes the obligation to conduct himself in accordance with its duties. So choosing the profession, once you have chosen the medical field, you have certain responsibilities thrust upon you, whether you like it or not, and you will have to behave accordingly. I remember the incidents when I was the secretary of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association. I decided to take a conference in Jalgaon. In those days, 10 years, 15 years back, Jalgaon was, and I still, it is a remote place for all the Maharashtra. So what I did is, I thought now we'll have to have a speaker where everybody would like to come. So I requested Dr. Sanchetti sir, senior, that sir, you will have to give a lecture on the topic I gave to you. Sir said, yes. But it will not be, it will be a non-orthopedic topic. So I said, yes, tell me. Then I gave him a topic, how to earn money. You know, Sanchetti sir talking how to earn money, there was a lot of crowd. Not only orthopedic surgeons, non-orthopedic surgeons, general practitioners, everybody, where we expected 120 delegates, the hall was full, 600 delegates. Because Sanjay sir, who is the most successful orthopedic surgeon in the country, is going to talk about how to earn money. So everybody was very interested. The first sentence of the Sanjay said, if you want to earn money, don't become doctor. Because this is not the place, this is not the profession for the people to earn money. And what he said next, if I had not become orthopedic surgeon, I would have become a very big industrialist. Ye bajaj phiro diya to kabhi sula diya hota. So you have a talent, you do the hard work, you do everything, but just remember, you have chosen a profession, doctor's profession. This is not to earn money. Money has to be a byproduct. Money is important. You have to earn money. Everything is okay. But not as a business. So, character of a physician, you have to know. I have just chosen few excerpts from the NCI. I am not going to deal on these legal issues much. I will be coming to clinical scenarios very soon. So, display of your registration degrees and registration number and all that is mandatory by NCI. You have to print it on every letter pad and your car and everything and all that. Now, where does the ethics come out here? Because I will give you one example. Now, if there is somebody who is, say, diploma in orthopedics, again we come to orthopedics, and he becomes, he studies and gets a degree of MS anatomy. So when he writes down his qualification, if he writes MS D ortho, that becomes an ethical and non-ethical issue. He is not MS ortho. He is MS anatomy, but he writes it as a MS D ortho. What do you say? Ethical? No opinions? What he is supposed to write is MS anatomy D ortho. So if he writes MS D ortho, it is absolutely unethical and illegal also. So that is why all those rules and regulations. Now there are a few things I would like you to know. Given by MCA also, you should give priority to the patient's interest. The physician should announce his fees before rendering the service, and it's always better because afterwards people don't pay. The remuneration received for such services should be in the form and amount specifically announced. You should not enter into the no cure, no payment agreement. That is also illegal and unethical. Now we go to one more topic, responsibilities of physician to each other. Consultant should not take charge of the case. So if somebody is not there and we deputize somebody and to look after his hospital, then I am supposed to go there, look after his patients, but not, I am not supposed to take his patient away to my hospital. You know? Similarly, I remember one incident where one of the surgeons in Kolhapur, he used to visit Miraj and Sangli area. In those days, it used to happen about 25 years back. So that senior surgeon wanted to go to UK for some studies for 3 months and all. So he deputed one junior surgeon, "Tum dekhte jao, Sangli Miraj, you keep visiting every week where I used to visit." After 3 months, the senior surgeon came back and the Miraj and Sangli people stopped inviting him because the junior fellow who was deputized to visit the things, he continued doing that. Actually, these are the things I am giving you practical experiences. This is unethical because you were supposed to take charge. It is like, see, somebody is going. Previously there were no lockers in the bank and all that. If I wanted to go somewhere else, I used to give my keys to the neighbors or keep the money and the gold with my neighbors. if after coming back that neighbor doesn't give me back the money or the gold I have kept, do you think it is legal and ethical? No, it's not. So that is why you have to remember all these things. These things you will encounter in your time when you start practicing, definitely. And then I hope you remember this lecture when you cross that particular road. Advertising, nowadays you must be seeing that so many advertising about different medicines and so on and what not. Every place, if you look on the page of a newspaper or a magazine, even on TV, social media and FMs, it is flooded. But you are not supposed to advertise, and physician shall not make use of his name, fame, degrees, qualifications to promote his own practice. These are all unethical acts. When you can display or go to public about it, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, starting practice, change of type of practice, suddenly I stopped practicing orthopedics and stuff, started practicing medical interviews because I am qualified in that also. So I can give an advertisement to you. From tomorrow onwards, I am not an orthopedic surgeon, I will be a medical interviewer. So there are very few instances where you can go public and change your address, temporary absence, another practice, something like that. There are n number of things in MCI. Those who are interested, go and see over there. Now we will shift to the clinical scenarios. They are more important than those medical issues which are given in MCI. Now we come to the clinical situations. Don't tell my mother. The old lady diagnosed with malignancy, age 80 something. The sons and the daughters, they will come in consulting room. Don't tell my mother, she will be afraid. Now you are stuck. As a treating physician, you are supposed to talk with the patient, you are supposed to inform the patient, and the patient is the only person who can take the decision about his and her treatment, not the sons and doctors and daughters-in-law and all. Now you are stuck because she is around 80, the son and the son-in-law and everybody is coming to don't tell her. She will be afraid. In fact, their mother has seen so much of world. I don't think any mother at the 80 will be afraid of anything. But still you are stuck up with this. Now how to tackle with this situation? Because not telling her, you are limiting your choices of treatment. Unless you tell her you are undergoing chemotherapy or a radiation or a surgery, how can you do that? But remember well, this is a scenario, day in and day out. Whether the son or the son-in-law or the daughter-in-law, they are capable of taking the decision, whether they themselves are understanding what we are trying to tell them. That is one more issue. Because most of my practicing friends will realize, after telling so much or so many things that it is very serious and the patient may die, at the end they will ask kaalji karne se kya nahi hai. So they do not understand. Many times the relatives, or they don't want to understand the hard reality. So this is one clinical situation whereas ethically and legally also you are supposed to disclose the things to the patient. You can't hide the things from the patient. Now what to do? How to go about it? I will just tell you what I do. I tell them, yes, we will not tell the mother. She will be afraid, she will do this and that. Absolutely, I agree with these people. But request them that let me talk to her all alone. I will be talking to her. I will be telling her my way. Don't worry, I am not going to tell. Then I go to the mother, tell her everything, that she is terminally ill, she may die within 6 months. The chances of 5 years survival rate is so and so and this and that, and then tell her, don't tell your sons, son and daughters and the doctor also. And it's a word for me for so many years. So you are neither unethical, you are not illegal. You can get out of that situation very well. One more situation is about this. Do not disturb. DNR is short form for this. Everybody knows that the old man or this person suffering from terminal malignant illness and all that is not going to survive. In European American countries, in the Western world, there is a provision in the law that the person can himself sign a form, do not resuscitate me. But unfortunately in India, we don't have that legal provision. So this becomes again a legal issue as well as an ethical issue. You know that the person is not going to survive. Now whether you want to do all those things which you know are futile, like terminally multiple metastases all over the body, everything is involved. So you still want to put that patient in chemotherapy, radiation and surgery and all that, when you know 100% that she is going to die, if she is going to die. Your job work would have been easier if there is a provision of DNA. Patient has said, no resuscitation, don't revive me, don't operate me, if it is a terminal illness. So this is one more issue where your ethics will come into play. Why I say so? Because if you want to earn money, you will do everything, you know, chemotherapy, radiation, multiple surgeries, this and that, knowing fully well that it's all useless. But an ethical person will keep the cards open, everything, and say, don't do anything, take her home. Now it will be their decision. This is where the ethics will come. One more situation is withdrawing life support. In fact, it starts with giving the life support. Again, the same situation, terminally ill patient, whether you should put him on ventilators and other type where you put other ICU and heart and other body, a brain dead patient. So when to withdraw? Indian laws, the legal system say the next of kin is going to take the decisions about when to stop the life support or whether to stop the resuscitation DNR, what we have said. But there are issues. When the patient is supposed, we know that she is going to die, but you do not know, nobody can tell when she is or he is going to die. So, if the patient is going to survive for few more months or weeks or days or hours, by withdrawing the life support, are you hastening the death? That is the issue. Now that becomes an ethical issue. Are you not hastening the death? If you give life support, she may or he may live for a few years or say few days or weeks. So when to do that? So then you will have to again think, use your best judgment and do the thing which is in the best interest of the patient after discussing it thoroughly with the patient. Maybe he has not done the will. He has not executed the will. By withdrawing the support, you are withdrawing an opportunity to execute the will. Maybe you can do that within a period of time. These are some examples which I will quote for. Euthanasia is one more situation. Now the Supreme Court has given a decision, but it is very vague. I don't think anybody will be able to do the euthanasia thing in the format which Supreme Court. Supreme Court has principally accepted, yes, in certain conditions, doctors can go for that. But that will, that can be a boomerang on doctors. The days are going bad for the doctors, so I don't think any doctors will take a chance of doing all those things for his patient. One more gray area where ethics will play a big role is assisted reproduction. There are many institutes and organizations there are many organizations and institutions where this assisted reproduction program is successfully done. The ethical issues arise when most of the time these IVF centers, they have multiple pregnancies. It's not only one, two or three. But the couple who is infertile for say 15 years, 20 years, they don't want to have three children at one go. They would say, no, no, I would only want to have one child. So what these gynecologists do is they do fetal reduction. Now people, ethical groups, they will say that by doing fetal reduction, you are, if there is three pregnancies, if you are killing two, so is it ethical to kill two babies in the birth? Before birth. And there is one more issue, selective fetal reduction, male or female. That is also there, that is also becomes unethical, illegal also. So this is one gray area where nowadays, now I don't know, but in short time you may get a law saying that you can't do the fetal reductions. If there are three, let the three grow. Cloning itself is at present not clinically practicable thing. But people have come up with the clones, and this will be absolutely unethical and illegal. No government is going to give permission to the clonings. But if by the time you start practicing, these things may become rampant, and you will have to take a decision on that about the ethical or non-ethical things. One more area where it's very gray area. A teenager wants to have a cosmetic surgery. This is an actual story which has happened in Hyderabad. One orthopedic surgeon friend, he got this boy around 24 years, 5 foot 7 inches, wanted to increase his height by 2 or 3 inches. Maybe his girlfriend was taller than that. I don't know. So parents must have refused those things. So he alone went to the orthopedic surgeon. He was around 25-26, IT guy, must be earning a lot at the age of 24-25. It's not possible that a doctor can go to have a cosmetic surgery at the age of 24-25. No money by that time. So he went to orthopedic surgeon. Orthopedic surgeon decided to do the limb lengthening by applying those two fixators. It can be done. It's not a big thing. You can use a razor or things, you can do those rail fixators and all that. The story starts here now. Because he is 24-25, he is an adult, he can give consent, he can get operated on him. Doctor has, under no condition, is under legal binding that his parents should be consulted or his friend should be consulted. No. Because he is a consenting adult, 24-25 years. He has paid the money. Everything is fine. The only thing is the parents went to the High Court saying that without consulting us, this doctor has done this. And now he is in pain. Who is going to nurse him? Because it is 1 millimeter per day what we lengthen. So if he has to lengthen for 2 inches at least, that becomes 60 centimeters. It's minimum 60 days. High Court directed the case to the MMC, Telangana or Andhra Pradesh Medical Council. It is nothing to do with law and you manager, whether he has done it right or wrong. Surprisingly, Andhra Pradesh Medical Council suspended the license of orthopedic surgeon for 2 years, saying that this was an unindicated surgery and it was unethical to do it. Because the average height of an Indian male is 5 feet 6 inches. So the person was more than average height of the Indian male. So even if patient comes to you and everything is legal, just remember there are some ways here. So his license was suspended for 2 years for unethical practices. So even cosmetic surgeries, they can put you in trouble. You have to follow the ethics, you have to counsel the person that yes, this and that. Change the girlfriend if you want, but don't do this. One more thing is adolescent with cancer. Adolescence is a very big issue. Age 16, 17, in the second decade, they are prone to malignant conditions. Physically, most of the times, they are fully grown at the age of 16, 20. Mentally, they feel that they are absolutely grown up, which they are not. Legally, they are not supposed to give the consent to surgery less than 18 years. So what to do? You have to take the decision along with the parents about the mutilating surgeries, the chemotherapy nowadays. The fertility preservation thing has come up. It is very easy for people to sit in Delhi and enact the laws. You know, every adolescent girl who is suffering from malignancy you are supposed to do the fertility preservation things. That is, you will have to pick up the oocytes of that girl and keep them preserved and give her a chance to have babies in the future. This is not an ethical issue, whether you want to do it or not. This is one more thing where you can be caught in dilemma about the ethics. And as I said, decision making. Whether you will have to take a decision from consent from the parents or from the child itself. I call it as a child. Now one more area is withholding and withdrawing. Again, an orthopedic example. See, there are many situations. A fracture, say intra-articular fracture of a particular joint, maybe a lower end joint. Ideally, it has to be plated. But patient doesn't have the resources for paying for it. So cheapest thing is to put the plaster. Now, whether it is ethical or non-ethical, when you know, you have explained that this will require surgery, but patient doesn't have the money, what will you do? The poor guy has to go somewhere. That is where your individual ethics will come into play. Whether you would like to go that patient untreated or you would like to treat him by the best possible way in the available resources. So putting the plaster is not illegal, you know. It's a legal way of treating the patient. So there are many of my friends in orthopedics that they will not treat such cases. They will say, kahan jana hai, ja rahe. But a person like me will give him options and let him choose option, because you can't serve karta hai to paisa to nahi karta hai nahi samajhta ki kya karna hai. So this is again a ethical issue, very gray area. One more example is doubtful diagnosis. Most of the times in our area it is a tuberculosis, chronic inflammatory conditions of the joints. We know that it is tuberculosis. By experience of so many years, everybody knows. But nowadays, unless you prove it by tissue diagnosis, you are not supposed to give anti-tuberculosis treatment, because we are having so many of multi-drug resistant clones and all. So when you are knowing that this person is going to be cured 100% by giving the anticoags, you are not able to give. So whether to start anticoags without tissue diagnosis is again an ethical issue. And suppose that condition doesn't respond to the treatment you have started, not only tuberculosis, any other drug. So whether to withhold the drug, at least not give the drug itself, knowing fully well that it may cure it, but it may not cure the person. That is withholding. And withdrawing, that I know that after 3 months, 4 months, there is no improvement. Now whether I should stop that drug, shift somewhere else, send the patient to somebody, that is a condition where we call it as a withdrawing. Again, that is an ethical issue. It is not a legal issue. What you are supposed to do? We are in time, I suppose. Surrogacy is one more thing, partly debated nowadays. What is surrogacy? Many people say it is selling the baby. Some people will say no. It is uterus which is on rent. So we are not selling the baby. It's the uterus which we have taken on rent. So that baby of a couple fertilized outside will be kept in the uterus. But the baby belongs to the couple. But the woman will know if she has kept that baby in her home for 8-9 months. She has an attachment. Now the ethics comes. Whether you have to take out that baby from her without her consent. There were some few cases in Gujarat where that lady refused to give that baby to the couple. Then she was taken to the court, and the court decided that she is the mother. If she has delivered the baby, she is the mother. And she is supposed to decide what to do about that. Only because she has signed some papers or documents, you cannot make it compulsory to hand over the baby to the original mother. So Government of India and many of the countries, they have banned the business of surrogacy, like kidney donors. Donation of the kidney can only be between these whatever 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 conditions without transaction of money. It is not for sale. Kidney is not supposed to be for sale. So if the uterus can be hired, the people say, then you can hire wanted labor also. I pay him 1 lakh rupees and he is supposed to work for me for 10 years. It is nothing but wanted labor for 9 months. So at present, at least surrogacy is under the category of if you take out the baby, it's a non-ethical issue. But it is again some grey area. But surrogacy as a business is illegal. There is one more issue I would like to tell you before closing this. Is this there are so many institutions, hospitals, where they advertise that we treat certain diseases by stem cells. There are conferences held in the country about stem cell therapy and all that. I would like to bring to your notice that treatment of disease by stem cell therapy is illegal in India. Not only in India, anywhere in the world. So what about bone marrow transplants? So bone marrow transplants are not stem cell therapy. They are simply bone marrow transplants. transcripts. Because as students, you may take some wrong messages from those advertisements of stem cell therapy. No, you can't do that. You can use the stem cells as stem cells only as a part of research, and you know how it is difficult to get the permission for a research project from so many committees and all that. So if somebody is, what is happening is, I will tell you, somebody is injecting some cells into the knee joint and saying that the cartilage will be regrown and all. And they label it as a stem cell therapy for cartilage regeneration. What they do is they inject the PRP, I suppose, plasma rich protein extract from blood. They will collect the blood, centrifuge it and put it into the joint, saying that it is stem cell therapy. It is not only unethical, it is illegal also. So ethical and legal conflicts. At the end, you will have to be aware that ethical and non-ethical thing you can debate, whether it is the individual ethics, community ethics and all that. But legal things are legal things. You can't have the say about that. So the gray areas again in the legal and ethical thing is, I usually give an example. A marriage between a brother and sister. Is it ethical? No. Is it legal? Yes. Two consenting adults can marry each other. No law prohibits a marriage between a brother and sister. So this is the best example I can give about the conflict of ethics and legal things. I hope you are reading, all of you, about the quotes I used to project. They are worth remembering. They are from a famous series of Dr. House MD, which used to run in US for almost 10 years. And I will recommend all of you, those who have not seen it, just download it from somewhere, get it from somewhere, or contact me. I have a pin on that of pen drive.
It is their job.
Netflix, yeah. And two more things I would like to recommend to all the students who are going to go get into the clinical practice is one book by A.J. Cronin called as The Citadel. That was written in 1917. He was a British physician. And the situation in our country is exactly what it was in 1917 in UP. Those who do not want to do or read that book, hold away, 1917 and something. No, I don't want to read that. They can at least go down and look or watch the movie by Devanand, Tere Mere Sapne, which is based on the novel of A.J. Cronin. The dilemmas of the doctor about ethical, non-ethical issues is very well handled in the novel and in the movie by Devanand. I think with this, because of these legal and ethical issues are very boring, I know. Let me stop over here, and with the permission of the organizers, if I can take some questions, I think we should go ahead. Is it? Thank you.
Where I am working in Banas University, one of the very famous physician, not a good nurse. He wanted his son to be admitted to internal medicine. But unfortunately, he could not get. So he got admission to come to routine medicine. And he used to come to me with his father and my friends. And I was in Florida. We told him, once I pass MD routine medicine, I will write my name, then I will write. The record is started, full stop, medicine, and the record closed. If we are and nobody will understand, but I have not written nothing wrong. It is only dot medicine. You will understand medicine, MD medicine. This is what he told me. I was surprised, you know, these are things going on in India. It is very funny, you know, he said, I will be talking to my father, this is not, use this word. Father, this is not good word for the medical profession. Second is about the referral. I was dead in PGI. As a resident, when I get a referral from any general practitioner, you got a very bad letter. Then you have this patient, is referred to us on this day. I have seen in the outpatient basis, and I have advised him this treatment. And I will follow up for 3 weeks, and I will send this patient back to you. Or second, you can write down that I admitted the patient. After 3 to 4 weeks, you will discharge, and then I will send the summary, discharge summary. Once you want me to follow it, I will do it, otherwise you don't do it. And this letter, you do not post it by the post. You can hand over it in the closed envelope and you can hand it over to the relatives. You save the money. This is the second thing. The third thing about whether you disclose about the illness or not. So I was staying in Banaras, one of the rented homes. The owner was about 70 years old. His wife was 60 years old. She was diagnosed with the malignancy of the uterus. And then they did not disclose it. They told that you have to go to everybody. It was long back, you know, it was, I think, around 1980. I passed the Abbyankar, just done my lecture. And then she survived for, I think, 20, 30 years. And then I researched. At that time, this Google was not there. You have to go to India's medical and everything. I found a paper. They have taken a sex and age mixed and told females to. The same type of diagnosis is same, you know, secondary. And one of the group, they disclose the illness. Other group, they did not disclose the illness. The survival is very high, significantly high in the group where the disclosure was not done. This is third of my, you know, comments. Fourth is that when I was working in England, I was very new that time, it was Liverpool. I got a call about 2 a.m. from the geriatric psychiatric. And the sister, nurse, she told me that one of the patients passed away, you come and declare to death. Death is only declared by the doctor, not by the nurses. I went there, I told, we should inform the family. She told, no, you cannot inform the family. You will take out the notes. They call it notes, which is rather fine. On the second page, that is the inner side of the front page, on the red, very big, it's written. The related to the instruction, if the patient dies between 8 a.m. to 10 p.m., inform me. If they die any other time, do not inform me, please inform after 8 a.m. So we open the file, it's written that don't inform me. So I could not do anything. The second scenario is written that you inform me immediately. If you inform the patient, then I will really know what to explain. Although I am a psychiatrist, I can do very good counseling, breaking the bad news. They came and the first thing they asked, doctor, tell me whether she passed away peacefully or not. So I was not doing she passed away peacefully or not. But I know, yes, she passed away very peacefully. Sleep. You are very happy. Then she told him to offer a cup of coffee. The coffee is very common. They put on the kettle with the coffee and they drank in their bed. And I put everything in their mouth. They were very satisfied. So these are some of my own experience about all these things.
And so sometimes you have to lie also.
Yeah. I mean, I have not seen. By the time I reach, patient died.
No work will do.
But luckily they asked this question, this answer was very easy, you know. She was sleeping and died, so I told her. So, these are some of the things. One more thing in psychiatry, like admission and discharge is not governed by any law in any of the departments, surgery, medicine, gynecology, pediatric. But psychiatry is governed by the law, and the law is known as Indian Lunacy Act 1912. It was revised, it is known as Indian Mental Health 1987. Now, again, it is revised, known as Indian Mental Care Act. 2016. In this act, the funny thing is there, they call it advanced directive. I can write down my directive that suppose I have developmental disorder, ECD should not be given. And nobody can give me security. Although I'm a writer, people can save me, doctor can save me. But this bird is there, advanced directive. This funny thing is that you are fighting, I think it will take 10 years. It takes 20, 40 years to change the law. So this is what our experience. Thank you.
To me, and say for some reason I'm not in position to give him a treatment. Supposing he's very sick and he insists on, say, there is a case of myocardial infarction, and the patient is not understanding, he wants that he should be treated on a monthly basis. Can I refuse treatment to him?
You should remember. Every doctor has a right to refuse. Only thing is, you should not refuse him in between, midway. You know? So, if somebody is coming and saying, as I have given you the example of treatment of the fracture, if he is advising the surgery, patient is not ready because he doesn't have money or some other issues, you can refuse the treatment, you go to some other place. Certainly, if you don't want to treat that patient because patient is not listening to what you are saying, you can flatly refuse the treatment. You have that right of refusal.
There is one component, one more component. Is it, take example, I am a psychiatrist and a patient in the UDS company, I don't know anything about that. So they use the word first aid. So the patient has come to go for the IV at the same. So I write down first aid is that. First aid is important word. Do something, you know. Back by the function, put the IV in the same. So first aid is covered.
What sir is saying is absolutely correct. In all my talks in front of these things, I tell the patient, I tell the audience, never inject intramuscular in an emergency. Because the concept of the general public is patient can die of an intramuscular injection, but always put an IV line. So the conception is patient never dies after putting a saline. You know, because saline laga diya to ho gaya bas. The treatment is over. So my practice in my hospital is if head injury patient comes, I don't entertain them nowadays. So what we do is we put a bandage, put a IV line. और उसको बुला देते हैं एंड माय ऑर्डर्स आर नॉट टू चार्ज. पैसा नहीं मांगा तो जल्दी बात है.
क्वेश्चन आई वुड लाइक टू आस्क डीसी सर,
there is a case of bipolar depression or schizophrenia. Okay. At the time of discharge, giving the certificate medical, can we write the disease on the medical certificate? Is it legal or illegal?
Now there are large changes and the MCIS gave very clear guideline about this certification. You have to write down diagnosis. But by the time what happened that MCI was not realistic, there is not much law. So we should write the isolated coding. Like to, I have to write 295, that is isolated and coding for schizophrenia. And he doesn't understand. There are Banaras difficulty in that all these students, even they are a criminal and politician. Now they become ministers and central ministry. I know these people. They are my patient, their mother is my patient. So when the examination they are part of the copying, they will just come, they will agree and get admitted. Middle of the night. In the morning I'll go for the round. So they will say, after you said a bit, I'm not normal and I got mental health, I was violent. That is why I shouted on the news leader. So we got a 14 means psychiatric. This is a number. Right? We should write, I think, 349. Write down ICD-10, 349. Nobody will understand. Only physician can decode it. So certainly we should be very happy, but it means there is no psychiatric illness. So this is what. Now this MCI has very clear guidance. You can see how the certification is done. Earlier in my time it was not there. Could write anything. Now there is a prescription in the body written, this is not very for the whole purpose. This is useless. You have seen the patient, you have to go. You cannot run out.
I have to go so many times, you know.
In the worst scenario, my question to Abhyankar sir, in the worst scenario where the doctor, where the counselor had suspended the doctor just for raising his height, so then how far are those companies which loud on TV is telling that aap itne dino mein slim ho jate ho, kharab hai mein wagera.
See, advertisement is different and execution is different. And threat dene mein jo guna hai, I will kill you. So many people say. So the punishment for saying so and actually killing is different. But I personally feel, my opinion is that Andhra Pradesh Medical Council had made a very gross mistake in doing that. And if I may say so, I do not know whether I should say this on this platform or not. These are all politically motivated games. Nothing else. Because